Markets rally to hit their highest level in 4 months. Nifty gains over 100 points to reclaim the 11,000 mark. Sensex also rises by nearly 1%. Tech, steel and energy stocks lead the way.
Midcap index turns positive in the last 1 hour, recovering more than 200 points from the day's lows. SRF, Dish TV, Reliance Nippon and Reliance Power are some of the top gainers. On the side of on the other side of the spectrum, Reliance Infrastructure loses a massive 35%. Tata Chemicals, deep in the red, IDB, a bank are some of the big laggards of the day.
Tech Mahindra is the top Nifty gainer of the day after posting stellar third quarter numbers. Meanwhile, Cipla gained 6% after posting 18% increase in its North American business. Lupin ends the day with minor gains after reporting a mixed set of numbers.
The Jubilant Food stock sees a volatile session swinging over 8% intraday. This after promoters backtrack on the royalty decision. Meanwhile, Dish TV sees a reprieve, gaining 19% after the 40% fall the stock had seen over the last 8 trading sessions. Zee Entertainment also continues its rise. It's up 6% by close.
And the Monetary Policy Committee gets into a huddle for the rate decision. Bond prices rise in trade today as hopes for a rate cut linger, although the CNBC TV 18 Citizens Monetary Policy Committee votes 3-2 for a pause. However, it is unanimous about a change in the policy stance to neutral. Well, those were the top 5 issues that dominated mindspace on Dalal Street. Hello and welcome to Markets Today Talk Back, the show where we will tell you everything that happened in those 6 hours of trading in just 5 headlines. I am Lata Venkatesh and with me my colleague Prashant Nair.
Hi. Lata, hi. And it did look a lot better even for the broader market. I mean, you know, in the morning, the gap between advances and decline was very large. It was almost 3-1. By close, I mean, advances and declines were almost evenly matched. Mm. So in that sense, a lot better. Over the next 30 minutes, as Lata pointed out, we will talk about the big stories which matter. Our guests will answer your questions. And we have our guests in the studios, Prakash Diwan on the fundamentals and Ashwini Gujral on the charts. Prakash and Ashwini, thank you very much for joining in on the show. But we are getting to the questions in just a bit. As always, let's spend 2 minutes talking about what really happened right from the word go. Lata.
Well, stocks climbed a wall of worry is all I can say. I mean, we've been complaining the mid caps are not moving. We're complaining that earnings are not up to speed. Auto stocks, auto sales are not up to speed. But, you know, the Dalal Street or Nifty is in its 4th straight day of ending in the green, or 5th if I'm not mistaken. And what a finish. A great number above 11,000. And it was not just one or two stocks. It was 44 out of Nifty 50 that ended in the green. So it's quite a broad sectoral participation. Some of the optimism today, incremental optimism, may be that on the back of a fiscal stimulus, we may get a monetary stimulus tomorrow in the form of a rate cut. Maybe that's what's fueling the hope. Or really, when you are worried, stocks typically keep rising. Midcap index, the only thing you can say for it is that it's ended in the green, which is more than you could say about it in the past several days. But the breadth is still hurting. The number of red stocks are more than green. You will have more color on the individual performance.
Yeah, I mean, Lata, I'll start with sectors as always. So sectors which did well, IT, metals, pharmaceuticals, energy. I mean, actually, there were even sectorally advances outnumbered declines. I mean, but those are the large sectors. I mean, the entire market doesn't get counted with these sectors. Usually, it's the big ones. In terms of Nifty gains, Tech Mahindra, clearly the big one. Cipla ending the day sharply higher. Zee continues its march up. So 6.25% higher. There was Bajaj Finance, Tata Steel and Grasim, which were some of the other gainers which we saw. In terms of large cap losers, Adani Ports numbers were actually pretty good. The stock was down 2.75%, but this was a cut even before the numbers came through. Maybe at the margin, it picked up a little bit by after the numbers. IndusInd Bank was down 1%. DRL was down about 1.25% really, nearly. Broader gains coming in. And actually, the one thing I noticed is that if you look at the list of gainers, you know, volume seemed to have really picked up on the upside in the broader space. So look at this. SRF, Dish TV, there was Reliance Power, HPCL, big gains, JSPL, Praj Industries. There was Sun TV, which was up about 5.5%. All very large volumes. Bandhan Bank, big one. CESE, and there were the housing finance companies, Group, PNB Housing and Indiabulls Housing, all three of them actually ending the day up. Indiabulls Housing the least, but the other two doing pretty well. And in terms of losses, it was the ADAG pack, Reliance Infra, a very sharp cut, Reliance Capital, 5.25%, 5.33% lower, and Tata Chemicals was down about 8% as well. Lata.
Okay, no, not me really. Straight away to Ashwini to find out what the charts are telling him about the market close. Well, 130 points higher and a distance over the 10,980. How do you interpret the day, Ashwini, and what is in store for tomorrow?
You know, a bull market is a market which has great euphoria, participation, etc., etc. What this is, you know, some ETF money getting into large stocks because Dow moves up triple digits every day, hence we have broken out. But this is not that kind of bull market which creates great multi-baggers and, you know, new stories coming out every day. So that way it's a bit different, but the markets are higher, that's a fact. So now what you want to do is any declines towards 11,000, 11,020 should be bought into, and now it's a buy on dip style market instead of the, you know, up and down we had earlier. But overall, does this mean, you know, Midcaps will start participating, etc.? I think they'll drop off in a couple of days, but you know, the narrow market, 10 stocks on the Nifty, they are likely to keep moving higher. You may even make a fresh high without you know, any participation from the broader market. That is on the table, but just a little bit stronger than where we were in the last 4 months.
Okay, so, you know, the market's moving up and you got to respect that. Buy the dips is what Ashwini's advice is at this point. We move on to the second story of the day. Midcap index turned positive in the last hour. The index recovered more than 200 points from the day's lowest level. As I said, advances and declines were almost evenly matched. Declines were a little more than advances, but not by that much. Dish TV, Reliance Nippon and Reliance Power were some of the top gainers. And on the losing side, as we discussed, Reliance Infrastructure, Tata Chemicals, IDBI Bank were the big laggards. We've got a question coming in. B. Jay Chandar Rao from Bangalore has written in with a query on Reliance Capital. He's been holding 1,000 shares of the stock. His cost is 482. He's been holding that name for the last 10 years. Says he's a long-term investor, he is. And he wants to know whether he should hold or sell. Prakash, what's the advice?
You know, this is the unfortunate part of holding on to investments for a longer term, especially when your thesis on the investing itself is not playing out. I mean, the move from 1,000 to 800 was fairly gradual. And it had its own reasons because there was consolidation happening within that space, and housing finance was still kind of just about to make its presence felt. The NBFC sector as a whole wasn't, you know, as thriving in terms of, you know, the P multiples. But from the move from 800 downwards has been fairly rapid in the context of the 10 years period that. So, you know,
mid last year.
Yeah, and that has been severe. That's been severe. I mean, it's been losing $50 every 6 months, you know. I mean, that's the kind of every quarter, that's a pace. So here, what I feel is, while yes, long-term investment does pay off, but if the stock that you've invested into is not playing out according to the thesis that you originally got attracted to, you need to get out. You know, you need to book losses and get out and sit aside and look at something else. So here, also, even at 150 whereabouts, you know, it's still probably not too late. You could still recover about 15% of your investment and get out, Mr. Ramchandra, and use that money to deploy in a much stronger franchise, which could play out and help you recover some, if not much, of the losses.
Okay. Yeah, till last September, Mr. Ramchandra was in the money. 482. It was 500, I think, on a stray day in September. After that, as you say, it has been,
it's been
50 rupees
severe.
Lower a month. Ashwini, what are the charts saying?
Well, you know, some people think time can, you know, bring stocks back. That's not true. I often hear, you know, longer term investors have no problem. Longer term investors are who lose 80% of their money. So first mistake, should not have lost more than maybe 20%. So now, you know, they are going down the tube. And obviously, who are these guys who are bringing the stocks down? These are all pledge shares, people who know what's happening. I wouldn't be surprised if all these guys get into the double digit soon.
That's not a distance now. Well, thanks for that, Ashwini and Prakash. We are getting to the third headline of the day. We shift our focus to earnings impact. Tech Mahindra was the top Nifty gain of the day after posting stellar third quarter numbers. And the IT majors' results were a beat on revenues, margins and on profits.
In the pharma space, Cipla gained 6% after the company reported a strong third quarter. The management remained upbeat on its guidance along with an 18% increase in its North America business. Meanwhile, Lupin ended the day with minor gains after reporting a mixed set of numbers. However, management commentary remained positive. The company said that the pricing pressures in the US was moderating and it was essentially back to single-digit levels. The stock ended the day in the green. Ekta is now joining in with the earnings highlights on both Cipla and Lupin. Ekta.
Well, I'll start with Cipla. That stock, in fact, reacted very positively to its numbers. Though the numbers overall looked like they were in line with estimates or maybe even a little lower. So, for example, the revenue was up only around 2.5% versus estimates of around a 6% growth. Margins were maintained between that 17 to 18% band and the profit was below estimates. But what probably was the positive with regards to Cipla's numbers was the US business, which was up 18% year-on-year to $118 million. The company is in fact sticking to its exit run rate guidance of $125 million in terms of US sales in Q4, as well as the filings that they are expecting in the US market in FY19 as well. For Lupin, however, it was a quarter which had a lot of one-offs. So, for example, they had a Forex loss to contend with. They had a loss on account of a litigation in the European Union. Plus, they had licensing income this quarter, which really aided their numbers as well. So the revenue was up 13-odd%, but adjusted for the licensing income, it was up around 7-odd%. That, too, was a little above estimates. Margins were aided by that licensing income, which came in at around 16.7%, better than last quarter's 13-14-odd%. And there was a loss optically of around 130-odd crores this quarter for Lupin. But the commentary is probably what sufficed, because the management did mention that pricing pressure is leveling out in the US, as well as they are focusing in terms of resolving their key issues with regards to Goa and Pithampur Unit 2 as well.
Okay. All right. Thanks a lot, Ekta, for all the numbers. Let's get to someone who's asking us questions on these stocks. Praveen Joshi from Pune has written to us with a question on Lupin. Has been holding 467 shares of this company, purchased at 1300 rupees. Okay, he's been holding it for the last 2 years, says he's long-term, wants to know if he should hold or sell. Well, tough, Prakash.
Yeah, but you know, this is not unheard of, or I wouldn't find this outlandish. The kind of drawdown that he's seen, he's probably seen all the way go down to 45-50% lower than his acquisition. But the way the stock is positioned now, Lata, and given the you know, management commentary, he could probably start seeing a little bit of a firming up on you know, the counter's price volume action, and which means it's an under-owned stock. People could start gradually coming in. Pharma is not in a very questionably difficult spot. So yes, he could see levels of 1200, 1300 come back in maybe, you know, a couple of years. And then whatever he gains beyond that will be his profit. So, you know, this on a longer term basis, on a CAGR basis, it might not yield more than some double digit returns. But he'll have to hold it for at least the next 2-3 years.
Okay.
Ashwini, what's your sense? Lupin?
Well, they are going through, you know, a tough time, maybe even a bear market, the pharma stocks. And his problem is not what they are doing now. His problem is where he has bought. So, you know, that way, one plan is you sell off and get into something like a Bajaj Finance, which is 200 bucks from its you know, previous highs. The other plan is you average here and average down strongly and maybe get your average down to 700-800, and then from there, you know, you hope that one day everything works out and the stock starts to move up. Personally, I don't want to lose so much money. So generally, I would have been out at say 1200. Moving on is a much better plan, because as we've seen with Sun Pharma, at every level, it was a cheap stock and keeps getting cheaper. That way, your hemorrhage will stop. So my opinion is move on to a Bajaj Finance and, start afresh.
Okay, wipe the slate clean. Thanks a lot, Ashwini. We'll come back to you after we take our first break. We're going to just do that and leave you with some market opinion that we got from Bharat Iyer, the strategist from JP Morgan. Listen, we are back in a jiffy.
I think there'll be a lot of noise, but which typically happens, and there will be volatility, and we have to be prepared for that. But ex that, I still think that earnings being a reasonable driver, valuations having come off, and the macro being stable, courtesy stable oil prices, I would say 11.5 to 12 is where we would see the market be. I think financials look interesting. We see a lot of value in areas like utilities and oil marketing companies. Oil has corrected meaningfully, and stocks are still very, very depressed. So that's one area that continues to look very good. IT looks okay. I think there are still some segments which are benefiting from government investment spend in various areas. So I think there's still a lot of value to be seen out there.
In strong day. On the Nifty, broader markets doing a lot better as compared to the last few trading sessions. We've been taking your questions. Prakash and Ashwini are our guests. They've been answering them. We move on to the fourth story of the day. Stocks in focus. Dish TV finally saw some reprieve. It gained 19%. Remember, the stock had fallen 40% in the last 8 trading sessions. Zee Entertainment also rose 6% today. The stock is from the lows 8 days, the crash lows 8 days ago, is up 35%. The Jubilant Food stock had a very volatile session, swinging over 8% intraday. From an opening gap up, which put the stock close to 1350 levels, the stock quickly lost initially and came pretty close to yesterday's lows. But finally, by close, the stock ended flat, a shade under 1300. There are, Lata, three things, which the market is still a little worried about. Not worried, but I think which is caused the stock to fully recover. One, of course, is that although these proposals have been reversed, the point is that they were tried in the first place. So that has kind of soured sentiment a little bit. The second, of course, is this doubt whether the promoter is going to use some other route to access that cash or cash flow of the company. If it is not this, what is it? And the third point, which has not been discussed that much, essentially is, what is the debt at the group level, at the promoter level. Is this a case similar to what we recently saw in the case of Z? Because the promoters, the Bharatiya family, have got interest in oil and gas, in drilling, energy, real estate. So, these are some capital-intensive businesses. So it's possible, and no one knows what's the debt at the promoter level. We know the pledging with Jubilant Foodworks is about 18%, 18% of their 45% shareholding. So, if the back is to the wall, they can pledge all 100% of the holding. So in that sense, the case is not very similar to the case what we've seen in Z. But I think it's one of the points and on which we don't have very much clarity.
Okay. So the market actually looking at it a little negatively. Okay, there is a question actually from one Vikash Garje from Odisha. He says he has been holding 100 shares of Dish TV. Purchased at 94 rupees. He wants to know if he should hold or sell. Prakash, do you track Dish TV?
No, yeah, I do. And, this is again a classic issue. I mean, it's very similar to a couple of other questions we had in the show where, things change, but people continue holding with this hope that long-term will repair all the damage. And here, the business model of the company when, Rajesh would have bought at 100 bucks and today at sub 30, it's diametrically opposite. Nothing much has changed, but a lot has in terms of the business itself, the revenue model. So, what needs to be done in these kind of investment decisions is that keep on evaluating that even if not too frequently, even on a yearly basis. And if you read an annual report and realize that the company is talking about some very different businesses or ways of conducting the business, then you need to question whether the valuation or whether the earnings are going to be justifying this kind of a price. And that happened to Dish at about 70-75 zones. Ever since that, it's been on a downfall. So from the 75 to 30 levels, I think it's not even taken more than 6 months.
Yeah.
So that's the kind of fall that we've seen, and you should have got out at that point in time. But if not, even right now, it's not a bad time. You still have about 30% of your investment that is still available. Take it off, invest into something else right away.
Actually, now that you notice, now that you say, all of them had started falling last September, July, September, when the debt market problems started. So you're now able to see that leveraged stocks were giving us those red flags probably mid last year.
They
on hindsight, you feel wiser, yes.
Yeah.
Okay, we move on to the last story. The Reserve Bank is all set to announce a sixth bi-monthly monetary policy statement tomorrow. The bond prices rose in trade today as hope for a rate cut lingers on. Though we must point out that the CNBC TV 18 Citizens Monetary Policy Committee voted for a 3-2 in favor of a pause. But they were unanimous. The committee was unanimous about a change in policy stance to neutral. I mean, this is a close one, Lata, isn't it?
Yes, I agree with you. Everybody will say that the stance has to change, but that doesn't change yields. What changes yields is only if there is a cut. And I, for once, have the temerity to disagree with the majority in the Monetary Policy Committee. I would think that there are very good chances of a cut because the data is saying that the last inflation number was 2.2. And even though the job of the MPC is to look forward, even if you looked 6-8 months forward, the arithmetic that most people are throwing up is an inflation at best at 4 or even below 4. And then, of course, globally also, you're getting these cues with the Fed moving away from rate hikes that things are going to be benign. Crude looks fairly stable. And therefore, my point is that at 2.2% inflation last reading and maybe less than 4 for the next 6 months, the space for a rate cut is definitely there. And then, you know, there is a new man who is less wedded to the Urjit Patel, committee and stuff like that. But that itself that argument can be made to stand on its head, that he may want to prove a point that he is not towing the line. There can also be a case made that fiscal deficit is a big issue. And do you need to give fiscal stimulus? Do you need to give monetary stimulus when fiscal stimulus has very openly been given? I mean, who will believe the number, the 3.4 is the deficit, if you counted what is under FCI, if you counted the very unrealistic revenue, tax revenue collection estimates, then actually the deficit is running above 4. So, the argument could well be made that there's already a stimulus and core inflation. That would be one big reason. Core inflation is still at 5.7. And with all this fiscal stimulus adding, it can, headline can go towards core rather than go towards food inflation. So, there is a very strong argument on the other side. One thing is very clear, that it's a new governor and therefore a new thought process. So will he bring some new things that he will watch out for? Will he say, let's not look at 1 year down the line inflation, let's look at the next 6 months where we will have a little more clarity? We don't know. So perhaps the statement is going to be important, and very quickly, even if there is a cut, at the most you will lose about 10 basis points on the 10-year. If there is no cut, then it goes 10 basis points more on the higher level. But for an NBFC or for a corporate, the borrowing price is not changing.
New governor and new time of the policy as well. It's at 11:45 tomorrow morning and not later in the afternoon, as was usually the custom earlier. Prakash and Ashwini, thanks very much, both of you, for joining us on the show and taking us through what you make of those stocks and sectors. It also brings us to a wrap on this edition of Markets Today Talk Back. From Lathami, everyone on the show, thank you very much for staying with us. More coming up on the other side.